shonens have a bad habit of making it that characters can be forgiven for just about anything. Rather, it's murder, rather it's betrayal, rather it's putting other people in harm's way, rather it's treating people they're supposed to care for horribly. Shonens a lot of times will let things basically just be forgiven and then forgotten about 2 minutes later. At its core, a lot of times, just because said character is marketable and can be continued to do so as such. Now, I'm not saying every shonen that does this is inherently bad, but it is definitely a problem, especially in the long-running big franchises. Yu-Gi-Oh! Has had this problem a handful of times in the past, and one would have assumed going into this arc we were going that direction with Go. Go basically, everything's fine now. He knows what he was doing was wrong. He lost the duel. He's back to wanting to help the children. Every horrible dickish thing he did in the last season, including Aiden cold-blooded murder, is completely forgiven now. Yu-Gi-Oh! Didn't go that route. Yu-Gi-Oh! Elected to basically set Go Onizuka on the right path. He acknowledged what he did was wrong. He wanted to make amends and help Playmaker and try and go back to doing things for the right reasons. They even did this nice little thing with his design, and that is he's kind of looking a bit back to normal. He's definitely not as skinny, and he definitely has a lot of his muscle mass back, but he doesn't look nearly as big steroid wrestle man as he used to be. That's a nice little visual metaphor that he's on his way to going back to being normal. One would assume that this is a nice little way to show what his arc is going to be from here on out. But instead, it's not. All of that is a misdirect, if you even cared at all about Go. Not everyone does. All of that just is in service of showing the cold reality of, no, Go Onizuka does not get forgiveness. He doesn't get to move on with his life. He doesn't get that happy ending. I mean, he probably ultimately will, but that's like 7 or 8 months from now. But essentially, what everything was happening here was trying to tell us, the audience, is that it doesn't matter what you learn. It doesn't matter how far you're trying to become as a person or how much you want to improve. If there are sins against you, you will pay for them. That is essentially what was done here. I'm not saying this is a message you should take to heart and remember in life. I'm just using this in the context of a goofy card game shonen. I wanted to stress that so no one gets all weird on me in the comment section. But no, essentially what I thought was very interesting about this whole thing is just kind of the way I phrased it at the end there, and that is, my friends don't get to come back. As if to just say, like, I don't get what you get, and one of them's partially gone because of you, and he's dead, you're not, guess what's now gonna happen? It's this very nice, very dark, very sad, cynical way to go about it. And I like they kind of bait and switch you for a little bit. They make it look like he's about to go down, and his last moments are gonna be a cliche, him thinking of the kids. Like, when he's like, no, where I've come from, or wherever he says in that scene. And he's like, no, I still have a strategy. Again, in that moment, you feel like, no, he's going to do it. He's got to continue his arc, right? Nah, you die, motherfucker. You go. And it was a really fun final turn he had there. Like, I was sitting there thinking for a minute, and as a Goki player myself, I kind of looked at the board he was setting and was like, no, that's Goki's. That is what that deck does, just minus the Nightmare Engine. Like, really, you could have seen him pulling off an extra link in that turn with how much he did, and I was kind of hoping the new Goki Link 4 would kind of be sort of like a weird Firewall Dragon replacement just to piss people off. I don't overly care. I don't know if I would even go back to that because I'm still enjoying my Thunder Dragons. I just think it would be really funny to see happen. But no, it was a very good duel. I like seeing the Earth Fusion. I love how every archetype that has a fusion is just now getting a worse super poly. Like, for a long time, Konami wanted to avoid super poly type effects for a long time, but then they're like, this game's gotten too stupid, just give them their super poly type effects. So that was pretty good. I wins, and there's something kind of cruel about beating Go before the 15-minute mark. I know, obviously, he had half of last episode, and that seems to be the pattern they're sort of going, everyone just kind of dropping like flies. But Go was a seriously well-promoted character. He was in a lot of the marketing, they made a ton of Gokis for him, and he got the big moment when he got to Duel Revolver at the end of the first season, and be that final handoff to Playmaker, like, you can do this! So yeah, to just see him sort of get unceremoniously thrown out, it's one thing to do it with Emma and Blood Shepherd, because those two characters just sort of got thrown in there, but Go was a highly marketed character from day one, and was even continued to be marketed in this arc where he was a villain. So to just see him get thrown out like this, there's this kind of cruel sting to it, and I really kind of like it. So yeah, that's what happened there. It's a very interesting send-off to the whole thing. And is it wrong that a part of me is kind of rooting for Ai? Like, I loved his whole attitude in the duel. Like, when they're about to do the thing where you think he's gonna lose, but no, he even plays it like we all know this cliche and we're just waiting to get it over with. That was good, and even his genuine sort of showing for Go, respect for Go as a duelist, was a nice, interesting little insight into the character. So then we get what was sort of the big reveal to why Akira and everyone just went into the weird area where I was going to get him or whatever that was about. And that is that they actually set it up to sort of trap Ai so that way Akira and Aoi could get out safely, as they are in a plane, like, what do they say, like 1,200 meters above Earth? I don't know the metric system. They're up in the air. And so what happens 20 seconds later? But Ai is just like, behold, I got a jet. Suck it, Tom Cruise. And he goes after them, and he boards the plane, and he probably just puts Akira's assistant to sleep. I choose to believe he murders her and blows up her brain, but that's just me. And then he goes to duel Pandor, and that's where our episode ends. One thing I kind of want to note about Pandor, the design is actually kind of creepy. Like, the way she looks, the big long neck, the very computeristic type voice. I don't know, maybe sort of showing what Ai is going to do with Pandor in the next episode, but kind of an interesting route. So yeah, that was this week. We said goodbye to a truly love-hate Yu-Gi-Oh! Character in that a lot of people loved him in the first season and then hate him after he murdered the weird Cheeto man. But yeah, there goes Go, and here we go. I'm just gonna do the joke now. I'm sick of these motherfucking card games on this motherfucking plane. So yeah, I did it. I'll probably do it next week, I won't lie. But tell me where you think this is going. Also, I want the at Ignister deck. Like, all the, not even for the monsters, like, we've got plenty of extra deck spamming decks out there, but I just want it for all the spell and trap cards that have Ai on them. That's it. That's all I want. But anyways, tell me that below. And as for the TCG question of the week, Euros was this past weekend. Altergeist made a comeback. And so I want to know, and I know Salad won, but Salamangreat is kind of the dominant deck, and America is sort of the anomaly. At least that's what the results are telling us. So I want to know, do you think the reason Altergeist made a resurgence is just because of people not wanting to be predictable, so they go with an off-ball choice? Or do you think it's that Europe seems to have a bit of a less aggressive playstyle than we do? I often notice when you look at Europe, they have this tendency to be more interested in kind of these control decks, kind of stun decks, and BA. They love Burning Abyss in Europe. Tell me about that below. And as always, click to like, click to subscribe, and join me next week for the body count continuing.